for he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I'll enter his courts with praise. I'll say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Come on.
Come on. Come on. A little more. There you go. Fine.
Good morning, everybody. We are off to a late start this morning.
Praise the Lord.
We know more people are coming too. Welcome. We're going to get started this morning. James chapter 5, verses 8 through 11. It says, be ye also patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. Grudge not one against another, brethren, lest ye be condemned. Behold, the judge standeth before the door. Take my brethren, the prophets, who have spoken in the name of the Lord, for an example of suffering, affliction, and of patience. Behold, we count them happy which endure. Ye have heard of the patience of Job, and have seen the end of the Lord, that the Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy. Mm-hmm. Sister Beth, would you open a word of prayer for us this morning?
Keep on the fire in life. If you and my brother show me, you must fight. Oh, keep on the fire in life. There are many dangers that we all must face. If you die fighting, it's no disgrace. The cowards in the service, they will find a place. Oh, keep on the fire in life. You must fight, be brave, against all evil. Never run, no reason I be hiding. If you will fight for God and right, oh, keep on the firing line. God only uses soldiers he can't trust. Keep on the firing line. If you bear a count and bear a cross, you must go. Keep on the firing line. Life is but a service for the master dear. We will defend the evil and spread good cheer. Pray for your reward be when you enter there.
So keep on the firing line.
You must fight, be brave. Against all evil, never run, nor even lie behind. If you will fight for God and His right, oh, keep on the fire in line.
One last time, you must
fight, be brave. Against all evil, never run, nor even lie behind. If you will fight for God and His right, oh, keep on the firing line. Will not be defeated. Will not be defeated anymore. Jesus scratch God's holy tongue. Fought the battles of no one, will not be defeated anymore. Will not be defeated, will not be defeated, will not be defeated anymore. Since the Holy Ghost came in, gave us power over sin, will not be defeated anymore. Amen, amen. We were talking about songs this morning that we haven't done in a while, and this is definitely one of them. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. From your burden of sin, there's power in the blood, there's power in the blood. Would you rebel a victory when there's wonderful power in the blood? There is power, power, going to work his power in the blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, church. There's power in the blood. Come for a cleansing, the cattle of the side. There's wonderful power in the blood. There's power, 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 wonderful power in the blood. Power, power, wonder power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be wider, much wider than snow? There's power in the blood, church. Oh, power in the blood. Since days are lost in that life giving flow, there's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There's power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Will you be servant for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, church. There's power in the blood. Would you lift daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, 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 wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There's power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. One time. Power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There's power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Amen. Brother Bill, I'm going to ask if you can come and help us receive our morning tithe and offering this morning.
Hallelujah, when we need our blessings, Savior in the sky.
Oh, what singing,
oh, what shouting, on that happy morning when we all shall rise.
Oh, what glory, glory,
hallelujah, when we meet our blessed Savior in the sky.
Some glad morning we shall see Jesus in the air, coming after you and me, joys I'll share. What rejoicing there will be when the saints shall rise, headed for that jubilee yonder in the sky. Oh, what singing,
oh, what shouting, on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory, hallelujah, when we meet our blessed Savior in the sky.
Thanks be now, I almost see all the saints again, rising for that jubilee that's just ahead. Millions,
I don't know.
Millions there will join that song with them we should be. Praise Christ with wages on heaven's jubilee. Oh,
what singing, oh, what shouting, on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory, glory, hallelujah, when we meet our blessed Savior in the sky.
Looks like I need to fix that song. Pastor, you got any announcements this morning?
We indeed have a few. Want you all to remember May 4th. It's a Thursday night. Ken Roberts will be with us. That's an exciting time. We're going to have him come, and he's going to speak to us, and he can tell you about some of the books he wrote, some of the ministry that he has, that he's going out. You'll be able, if you're interested in joining his blog and doing some things, I believe it's completely free, so it's a good thing. But remember that. June 4th, Pastor Bill Black will be here. That's our 30th anniversary here and 40th anniversary in ministry. That's, wow. That's a lifetime. Amen. So we're excited about that. Also, for kids 8 to 12, July 10th through the 14th is camp for them down at Lake Darling. Please see Becky. We need to know who's going, how many's going, who wants to go. And then also, July 17th through the 21st is 7th through 12th grade camp. If you want to go, see Becky about that. We need to get an idea on how many people are going. It looks like we may have a few scholarships available. So let us know, 17th through 21st, or 21st is our junior senior high camp, and that will be in Chicago up at McHenry County, actually in McHenry, for that week of camp. It'll be an exciting time. So those are coming. Also, for the ladies, and guys, if you want to wear a dress, okay, that we can take a snapshot and put all over the internet. Just want you to know. May 13th is our ladies' luncheon. Becky about that. I believe that's $15 a person, and it's in Cedar Rapids. They have it every year for the ladies. So that's coming up on Mother's Day weekend, May 13th. Do I have them all right now? Yes.
That's all I've got.
Okay. Good. I did pretty good without notes.
More than the air I breathe, more than the song I sing, more than my next heartbeat, more than anything. Father, as time goes by, I'll be right by your side. I never want to go back to my old life.
Can you sing that with me one time? I never want to go.
I'll offer up this praise unto your name.
one time.
You are worthy.
Jesus be the Lord of all. Jesus be the Lord of all. Jesus be. Jesus be.
So we need to pray.
Amen. She is home.
Yeah, they went home. home, but there's a lot of problems there. So we need to pray for that baby.
Amen.
And Mama Teague and her family are all gone to Chicago, which kind of cleaned out a lot of the church. And Sister Mary Richard, we need to pray for her. You know, as a church, we are a family.
Amen.
This is part of our family.
That's right.
And so we need to pray for those who are not here. You know, they're not here because they don't want to be. It's because they have other things going on.
That's right.
And they're wonderful enough to let me know so my insecurity doesn't get a hold of me. But let's just pray for our family. Amen. Those who are in need. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we just come before you and we pray. Lord, for all of those in need this morning, we pray for that baby in the name of Jesus that you would minister to it and touch it and its body. Lord, that it would be able to survive and live on its own without help. Father, with the breathing problems, Lord, that you would just minister your might and your power to that. Father, we just pray for those, Lord, in our family who are gone from us, Lord, because of this or that or the other. And we ask, Lord, that the Holy Spirit would be upon them, that you would bless them. And Lord, that you would come down upon them with your presence. Lord, and that you would glorify yourself in them. And Lord, that they might know that wherever they are this morning, some who are working, some who are visiting family, some who are doing family events, some who are ill, Father, that you would touch them and that they would know, Lord, that there is a family praying for them that's got their back. Yes. And Father, right now, I just pray, give you praise and I give you honor and I give you glory for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to let the kids go. Those older ones can help with the younger ones. Put them one-on-one with. Okay, with. I'm actually excited about that. Now that you do have books that can help and minister it in that nature. If you have your Bibles this morning, turn to me with me to Psalms 145. Psalms 145.
Get it to be really clear.
Now I'm going to bounce around a little bit, but I'm going to basically be off of about the first seven verses of Psalms 145. As we started the study, and it's been broken up a little bit, and will be broken up because of Father's and Mother's Day, but that's fine. This will give you an idea of just kind of a recap. I talked about five power words that bring intimacy. And the last time I was with you, before Easter and Palm Sunday and Easter, we talked about the first power word that brought intimacy, and that was the word of repentance. The second power word is the word praise. Praise, which we're going to deal with this morning. Power words that lead us into intimacy. If I know somebody, I know them, most of you I know I know your name, I know a lot about you, all that, but I really don't know you. And to give you the biggest example of this that I can think of, it's a wonderful example, is you meet somebody and you're attracted to them. I met my wife over 40 years ago, and I became attracted to her. And she chased me, and she chased me, and she chased me. At least that's my story. No, actually, the first time that I met her, she couldn't stand me, if you want to know the truth. And I finally won her over. But the thing was that we went through a relationship where we knew each other, and then we got to know each other a little bit better and a little bit better and a little bit better, and then we decided that we fell in love, and that was a wonderful thing. And then we got married.
Praise the Lord.
And we found out, or she found out, that she didn't marry the guy that she thought she was marrying. And I found out I didn't marry the girl that I thought that I was marrying. Why? Because I really didn't know her. And many of you, if you're honest, will say, man, that's a lot different than what I thought I was getting. You know, it's kind of like bait and switch. You get baited, you get on the hook, and then you get the real thing, and you say, oh, Lord, have mercy. You know. I say that to say this. There are a lot of people who know Jesus, and they might know a lot about him, but they've never really had a relationship of intimacy with him. That relationship of intimacy is the only one which will not let you down. And it's a relationship that causes you to grow fonder every day. Now, over the years, I have grown a lot fonder of my wife because what? We know each other. She can sit back there and she can give me a look and tell me whether I'm going in the right way or the wrong way. She can say things to me. Doesn't. And one thing she says, listen, you know, I one reason why she doesn't preach, she says, all I have to do is say two sentences and I'll clean out the church. You know, because she does not mince words well. She'll just lay it right to you. But Psalms 145 talks about the value of praise and the value of coming into praise that bringing intimacy. And as you look at Psalms 145, David is speaking here, and he's to a point where he's beginning to understand the value of praise. And he says, I will extol you, my God, O King, and I will bless your name forever and ever. I will extol you, O God, and I will bless your name forever and ever. David came to a place in his life, and a place in his praise life, where he did not care. He was going to praise God. We need to come into that attitude within our life that we don't care. We're going to praise God no matter what. We're going to lift him up. We're going to glorify him. We're going to magnify him. We're not going to be ashamed of who our God is. And as you come into your relationship and your prayer life, last time I said you need to come to an attitude of repentance, but it doesn't end there. Here's where you need to begin. You need to begin to praise him. Start giving him praise. Start thanking him for what he's done. I will extol you. I will praise you. I will thank you. All those attributes are wrapped up in this one word in verse 1. And I will bless your name forever and ever. Praise needs to be a priority in our time together with the Lord. You will get more out of any relationship that you are in if you learn to praise. If you Listen to this very carefully, because I'm gonna say it at the risk of being misunderstood. If you are not praising, you are taking for granted. I'm learning something. I'm learning to tell my wife more and more I love her. Why? Because it's a form of praise. If I don't tell her I love her, I'm taking her for granted. If you don't tell Jesus you love him, you're taking him for granted. If you're not praising him, you're taking him for granted. I have a very private time where I spend with the Lord, and I just need to have that time of privacy to make praise a priority. Because it's between me and him. It's an intimate time. See, after repentance, praise is the key to unlocking the gateway into God's presence. It's, you know, you come to him, you say, okay, Lord, I repent of my sins. Hallelujah. I come and I have a relationship with you. Now, what do I do? I begin to praise him. I begin to step into the second door. I begin to ask God to begin to move in my life. And since praising God helps lead us into a place of intimacy, it's important to understand what praise exactly is. I want to take you to Psalms 100, verse 4, and then we're going to come back a little bit later to 145. So hold your finger if you go. Psalms 100, verse 4 says this: enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. Now, I want to give you the Hebrew word for praise in this verse. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving. I will enter his courts with praise. The Hebrew word for praise is tehillah. Okay? Tehillah. It's not tequila. It's tehillah. Nor is it tuhela. Okay? We were talking this morning, and Mike said he heard an old-time preacher say the Hebrew word was tuhela. Let me tell you, if you don't praise him, tehillah it will be. Okay?
Amen. Rock some little lips and start shouting.
Tehillah. Tehillah is the Hebrew word. I will enter his courts with tehillah, which means celebration. I will celebrate. I will laud someone or something that is worthy. I will enter his gates. I will come into the room with thanksgiving. And then I will enter his courts into the room with praise, with celebration. Church ought to be a celebration of who Jesus is. David realized that. And when we celebrate or we praise his goodness and declare truths about his worthiness, we, number one, we celebrate him for what he's done, what he's doing, and what he's going to do. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Has Jesus brought you out before? Can Jesus bring you out today? Yes. Will he do it again tomorrow? Yes. I learned to celebrate who God is and the victory he brings. We praise him to acknowledge his greatness. He is great. Lord, you're a great God. Now going back to Psalms 145, verses 2 through 7, you see something. Says this: every day I will bless you. Every day I will bless you. And I will praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise your works to another. and shall declare your mighty acts. I will meditate on the glorious splendor of your majesty and on the wondrous works. Men shall speak of the might of your awesome acts, and I will declare your greatness. They shall utter the memory of your great goodness and shall sing of your righteousness. Back in the 70s, we used to sing this. How long has it been since you talked with your Lord and you told him your heart's hidden secrets? How long since you prayed? How long has it been since you honestly got down before the Lord and you spoke to him and you said, here I am, Lord. I'm just coming to talk with you. I'm not coming to beg you for anything. I'm not coming to ask you for anything. I'm not coming because I'm in trouble. I'm not coming because I'm in despair. I'm coming just to talk with you. See, those are the times where the greatest influence of the Holy Spirit moves in your life. When you don't have something that you want. My kids come to me always wanting. I can never understand their love. Do you understand what I'm saying? But if my kids come to me because they love me, I can begin to understand that they don't want anything, but they concerned about me and who I am. Correct praise always includes thanksgiving. Again, David in Psalms 136, verses 1 through 4, will give thanks to the Lord, for he's good, and his mercy endures forever. Oh, give thanks to God of gods, for his mercy endures forever. Oh, give thanks to the Lord of lords, for his mercy endures forever. To him who alone does great wonders, for his mercy endures forever. Thank him for what he's done. Thank him for his mercy. Tell other people about what he's done. Tell other people about his mercy. See, our praise before God, listen to this very carefully, because it's when we get wrong a lot. Our praise before God is based on his greatness, not on our emotions. How many of you got up this morning, got out of bed, and you rose up and you said, oh man, I feel saved today? I bet you none.
I just said, thank you, I can get out of bed.
There are times where we don't feel saved. How many of you know what I'm saying? There are times where we don't want to. I got up this morning and my wife tried to get me up 3 times. I'll just be honest with you. And I was tired, and she knew I was tired. And I kind of overdid it yesterday, and I said, oh, let me just go back to sleep. So her mercy said, okay, let him go back to sleep. Let him rest a little bit. In my emotion this morning wasn't on, oh, I'm so excited about coming and sharing the word with people. My emotion sat at the Church of Mattress and Spring, Reverend Pillow. You know, Lord heaven, the pillow foot. But I knew something in my spirit saying, hey, you got to move out of that attitude and move into an attitude of who God is. See, we choose, and we need to choose, to praise him regardless of how we're feeling. We need to choose to praise him regardless of how we're feeling. Repentance is an attitude, forgiving. Praise is a bigger attitude. And praise is positional. What do I mean by positional? Praise positions you to walk through the gate and into the courts of praise. Have you ever had something that was a little bit big and a little bit tight getting it through the door? And what did you have to do first? You had to position it so that it would go through the door. You in your spiritual life have to position yourself to move into new spaces with God. An attitude of position. When David was overwhelmed with despair, he commanded his soul to praise God. He is the help of our confidence. When things go wrong, the last thing we feel like doing is praising the Lord. How many of you know what I'm saying? And I can pick on her because she just walked in. She's late, so I'll pick on her. This week, Robin's went through quite a bit with her grandson. And we prayed for him a little bit earlier, but during that time that she was going through that with her grandson, I would say to her, if she was totally honest with us, she would say, I didn't feel like praising God. I was more worried about my situation. You see what I'm saying? So you have to begin to take an attitude that I will praise God. I'm not going to look at the attitude. I'm going to praise Him. David in his despair, same thing. David's in complete overwhelming situation. In Psalms 43, and he says, why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise Him, the help of my countenance and my God. Why are you cast down? What David was saying to himself was, why are you looking at your situation when you should look up at the helper of your situation? And why are you so loaded down with your situation when God is your hope? Hope in God. And as I begin to hope in God, I begin to do something. I begin to praise Him, and He will change my countenance. He will change my outlook. He will change my attitude, because praise, again, is an attitude that positions you to enter into His courts. Why do we praise God? I could spend a lot of time on this, but I'm going to give you five things real quick, and then I'll give you scriptural references, and you can look them up later. If you need them later, I can give them to you. Number one, why do we praise God? Because it declares He's worthy. Simple. He's worthy of our praise. You are worthy of my praise. You're worthy of our praise. Psalms 48:1, 145:3, Revelation 4:11, and Revelation 5:12. Why do we praise God? This one's a difficult one. It demonstrates my obedience. In all things, praise Him. Psalms 151, 81, 1 through 4. Why do we praise God? It defeats our enemies. Satan, every demonic power cannot come against praise. Because praise brings the army of the saints. If you want backup, praise Him. It will defeat your enemy. about some situations that were going on with several people in the church this week. I said, okay, God, what am I supposed to do? I knew, but what do I do? Do I get involved physically? Lord, you know that I've got my own things going on, and I really can't do much. And the Lord says, you can praise Him. So every situation that I came up of, that people gave me word about, that they needed, something needed prayer, or someone needed prayer, I begin to praise God over the person. And in every situation, I'm starting to see God move, and victories come. I understand the baby went home. Is that a victory? You take a baby that cannot breathe on its own, it stops breathing, and they send it home. That's victory. Do you see what I'm saying? Begin to praise over your situation, over people. I took time this week to praise over every one of you. Couldn't do much else. So God said, okay, begin to praise over people. Let the Holy Spirit come down upon you. Jesus, move in their lives. Defeat their enemies. You see how it works? And when I can't praise for myself, I need somebody else to praise for me. That's the reason why this attitude of praise is so important, and intimacy with God is so important. You might be the catalyst for deliverance in somebody else's life. You know, you talked about intercession. Intercession begins with praise. You know, we all want to be intercessors. But if we're not praisers, we can't be intercessors.
Amen.
Defeats our enemies. Psalms 8, 1 and 2, 18, 1 and 3, and 46. 49, chapters 46, 49. Fourthly, it will deliver you from your affliction. It will bring healing. Praise brings healing. Isn't that a different thought? What do I mean praise brings healing? Praise brings us to a spiritual reality that causes us to understand that greater is He that is in me than he that's in the world. Lord, I come before you and I pray. I come before you with an attitude of just, Lord, saying, you know my afflictions. You know where they're at. You know my hurts. You know my weaknesses. Now I pray, Lord. Two or three people in the last 2 days have said, hey, listen, I have weaknesses in this, I have weaknesses in that, I have weaknesses in that. And I've made mental notes and I'm going to write them down because I tend to forget. But you know what my job is? My job is to now begin to praise God over them, Lord, right now. Begin to move over that affliction within their life, over that weakness within their life, because an affliction is a weakness. And Lord, right now, bring your spirit in to strengthen them against every affliction. And the last one, it will defy your circumstance. You know, we're so busy sometimes commanding Satan to go that we forget to praise Jesus to come in. You hear what I said? We are so busy sometimes commanding Satan to go that we forget to praise God for the Holy Spirit to come in. And what we do is we leave an empty, broken vessel, not allowing the Holy Spirit to move. Let's understand the why of praising God. We don't praise God because of His need.
We praise him because of our need. Newsflash for you, you ready? God doesn't need you. He doesn't need me. He wants you. God does not need you. He does not need me. He wants you. And more than that, he chose you. He chose you. When we praise him, we're acknowledging that there is only one God and that he is Lord of over all our life. Jesus be the Lord of all. Jesus be the Lord of all. Jesus be the Lord of all the kingdoms of my life. We're made up. We're many kingdoms. I don't know if you know that. We're many kingdoms. Some of you are a brother, a son, a father, and you. Those are different kingdoms all wrapped up in one person. Jesus wants to be Lord of every kingdom of your life. Praise God causes us to draw on his strength for victory in all our situations. And praise will lift us up out of our troubles and position us to receive. Position. See, praise, again, is positional. It positions us to receive what? Number one is presence. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I come before you, Lord, thanking you, but I enter into your throne room praising you. You see, thanksgiving stops at the door. Praise begins in the room. Get what I'm saying? You know, we can thank him. We can thank him. We can thank him. And then, as we enter into his throne room, we begin to praise him. Positions us to receive his peace. His peace. You're doing good. He is my peace who has broken down every wall. And just as Jesus ripped the veil between the holy place and the Holy of Holies, Jesus wants to rip the veil in your life and bring you into peace. Thirdly, it positions us for power. And you shall receive power, dunamis. After that, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Power. Fourthly, it positions you for protection. Thank you, Lord, for your protection. Thank you, Lord, for coming and surrounding me. Against all odds. And fifthly, it positions you for provision. Provision. The Lord is your provider. If he made you, he can provide for you. When we praise him, we are affirming our belief that he's in control of everything around us. Amen? Everything. How do we praise him? The intention of God that our praise be dynamic. Dynamic. Dynamite. We need a few Jimmy Walkers in the church. That's for you older folks. Hit dynamite. Dynamite! Oh, yeah. Let's have some dynamite praise. Dynamic praise. Life-changing praise. It should be enthusiastic.
It should be enjoyable. This past Friday night I didn't go, but I heard about it. I was at an event yesterday and there's some folks talking about, oh, did you go to the scrimmage Friday night of the University of Iowa football? Oh, wasn't it a good time? I'm thinking it's a scrimmage. You're playing each other. There wasn't even a game going, real game going on. It was just something that was there.
They won.
They lost.
Yeah, they won, though.
You find what I'm saying? Catching it? Dynamic. And those people were dynamic. Woo, woo, woo! They were excited about nothing. And they were enthusiastic. We're going to have a great year next year! Hallelujah. And they enjoyed the game. Well, let me tell you something. If their praises can be dynamic about nothing, if they can be enthusiastic about something that has not happened yet, if they can enjoy something that has no worth, why can't we have a dynamic, enthusiastic, enjoyable praise life with the living one of eternity?
Amen.
The definition of praise, I've told you before. How many of you know what definition of praise is? Here it is. You ready? Raise your hands. Jump up and down. Turn around in a circle and act clamorously foolish.
That's right.
That's the definition.
It is. The heel of praise. It is.
How do we praise God? You know, we come to church to be entertained. Come today to be entertained. Well, good for you. How about coming to church, not just to entertain, but to partake? Psalms 47, 6 and 7, sing praises to God, sing praises to our King, sing praises, sing, for God is the King of all earth, sing praises with understanding, sing. I don't care what you think of it. I don't care. And no matter where you've been, because there's all different kinds of worship teams all over. Okay? But if you're coming to be entertained, you're not coming to give. And heaven help the worship team that is coming to entertain and not coming to lead you into worship.
Amen.
Because if you're not moving into worship, if you're not singing before the Lord, there's a problem. Let me sit by the side of the road. Sing praises. Ephesians chapter 5, 19 and 20, speaking to one another, psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And let me tell you something. God did not say you had to sing in tune.
That's right.
Amen. God said just to sing. Sing. Literally sing in the shower. We'll get out of the shower and start singing. Make a joyful noise. I told you about the attitude where God spoke to me about that. I was in Bible college and I went to visit my brother who was in the first year of ministry in Bloomington, Illinois. And they had the lady they called the moose or the cow. She always sat at the back of the church. And the music would start going, and people would start singing, and you hear worst noise imaginable. But you know what? You're making a noise to the Lord because you can see you're back there lifting your hands, praising God. Just lifting your hands and praising God. Sing. The second is by shouting. Shouting. Again, the same group of guys that I heard speaking last night. I'm overheard. I probably shouldn't eavesdrop on other tables while I'm eating, but I did. Talking about, I shouted so much I was hoarse. Shout. Psalms 98, 4 through 6. Shout joyfully to the Lord all the earth. Bring forth in song, rejoice and sing praises. Sing to the Lord with the harp and the sound of a psalm, with trumpets and the sound of a horn. Shout joyfully before the Lord your King. Brings us to the third thing, by making music. If you have the ability to make music, make it.
Amen, Sister Kathy.
Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the lute and the harp.
Amen.
Praise him with the timbrel and with dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and flutes. Praise him with loud cymbals. Praise him with the clashing cymbals. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. That's Psalms 153 through 6.
Yes, amen.
Y'all can play an instrument. Y'all can play an instrument. Which brings me to the fourth thing. Lift these up.
Just lift them up. You ready?
Let's try it. Turn them palm to palm toward each other and go like this. That's an instrument!
It is.
A praise.
It sure is.
Clapping. Psalms 47:1. Oh, clap your hands, all ye people. Shout to God with a voice of triumph. Sometimes you just need to get alone, and when situations are rough and they're tough and they're hard, and you see things going on, you just need to get to the Lord and shout to the Lord and clap. Thank you, Jesus, for ministering in my situation. Thank you, Jesus, for overcoming the evil one. Begin to clap before the Lord. Begin to shout before the Lord with a voice of triumph.
That's right.
By lifting your hands. Psalms 134, 1 and 2. Bless the Lord, all ye servants of the Lord, who by night stand in the house of the Lord. Lift your hands in the sanctuary and bless the Lord.
I don't want to embarrass myself. What will people think if I lift my hands?
And I don't care if you put on your deodorant or not. Lift them. Let other people suffer. Lift your hands. Psalm 63, 3 through 4. Because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise you. Thus will I bless you while I live. I will lift my hands in your name. See, the Hebrew word for hand is Yah. Yah. And the verb form is Yahda, meaning to praise by lifting my hands. I'm going to give you another word where hand is dealt with, but we're not going to deal with it. And they saw Yahweh, the hand of God. Lifting hands is an outward expression of an inward experience of praise. I want to go back to David for just a moment. Because David had a wife named Michal.
Saul's daughter.
And Michal had a problem.
Oh, yes, she did.
Because David was out in the streets in his underwear, running through the streets with his hands lifted up, praising God. Michael's embarrassed. And actually, the Bible says that Michal despised him for his exuberant expression of praise. See, some might despise you for your exuberant expression of praise. Do it anyway. Because we can reply the same way David replied in 2 Samuel chapter 6, 21 and 22. So David said to Michal, "It was before the Lord who chose me instead of your father and all his house to appoint me ruler over the people of the Lord, over Israel. Therefore I will play music before the Lord, and I will even be more undignified than this, and will be humble in my own sight. But as for the maidservants of whom you have spoken, by them I will be held in honor."
Also, this closes. I don't hear him on here. Only out there.
Many of you know about the microphone, right? The word where it talks about the stones will cry out if we don't cry out in praise. We look at that a lot. See, praise is not something that's reserved for the church only. Praise is an attitude. You got to have it. You got to develop it. I love seeing my grandson when it's posted. And even though he clams up in front of people, he's not going to be that way too long, hopefully.
So I had to turn it back on.
But
which is what gave you a little more bass.
I've seen a video. Father Abraham had many sons. Many sons had Father Abraham. And I am one of them. So let's just praise the Lord.
Right arm.
Child of God. So let's just praise
the Lord. Amen.
It's an old song. Let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our voice to heaven and praise the Lord. Praise Him. Lift Him up. I want you to understand one thing. Praise is not a guarantee of intimacy with Jesus. You can sing loudly, clap enthusiastically, and even dance all night. That's only a beginning. Intimacy involves more than just praise. Luke 19, 37 through 40. Then as he was now drawing near the desert of the Mount of Olives, a whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, saying, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." But he answered and said to them, "I tell you, if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out." An attitude. What is an attitude of praise and intimacy involve? It involves of laying hold. The word in the Greek means to seize, to apprehend, to possess. Paul in Philippians chapter 3, 12 through 14 said, Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended But one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press towards the goal of the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. See, praise is the second step. Repentance is the first. Praise is the second. What's the third? May you remember? Worship. Worship, praise. You into worship. Constantly leading you closer and closer and more intimate with Him. Offering and sacrifice. We're at a point. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul.
Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul.
Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation, so through Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
And then you go into the second step, where you position yourself and you open the door to walk into His courts. I will enter His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter His courts, the outer court of the temple, with praise. Now I can see a lot more. I can see what God has established in the brazen altar. I can see the altar of incense. I can see all those other things around me that God has prepared for me. And, hallelujah, I can see right in the middle the Holy Holies. I'm walking toward the Holy Holies. I'm walking toward intimacy, praise. And I get so involved in my prayer. I actually fall to my knees and I begin to worship because I come into the presence of God. That's where we're going to be at next week. I begin to worship Him. I begin to praise Him. I begin to see His glory come down upon me and move into me. So I begin to experience the presence of God. Not just to know who He is, what He's all about, but I begin to experience Him in worship. That's the reason why I'm so excited about this. Power words of intimacy. Boy, if we could get a church of intimate people with God, we'd blow the city apart in the presence of God. Enter His gates with thanksgiving in His courts with praise. Let's pray. Father, I thank You. I thank You, Lord, for Your glory. I thank You, Lord, for Your presence. In the understanding of who You are. Let us come before You. Lord, let us come before You in constant repentance, thanking You for cleansing us, thanking You for changing us, thanking You for allowing us to come to You. But let us then walk in the presence of praise, into the courts of praise, that we can see more of who You are and exactly what You've done for us. Lord, thank You for that. I praise You for that. You're here this morning and you would say, yeah, I've come a little ways, but I need to come further. Just lift your hand to the Lord. Let Him know. Lord knows. Lord knows. He wants to guide us. He wants to position us to walk into the court of praise. He wants to position us to understand who He is so that we might be able to praise Him. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, move by Your Spirit. Lord, to do a work of Your power and Your presence. Now I pray for each and every one of us, Lord, that we would position ourselves to enter into Your courts with praise. Father, I thank You for leading us and guiding us in that direction. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen.
Let there be glory and honor and praises. Let there be glory and honor to Jesus.
So that we may greatly know You. Oh, in the name of Jesus, I commit this congregation into Your hands. I ask You to take them safely home and bring them safely back again. In Jesus' name, and the church said,
amen.
Amen. Shake somebody while you're friendly.